I'm glad everyone's enjoying stories of my dysfunctional family. It's quite cathartic to laugh at them now, even though they weren't really funny when you were living through them. To everyone asking why we didn't cut Carol off after the first incident, well, you've severely underestimated how dysfunctional my family is. Over time, we found that it was just easier to deal with Carol in person because she could throw some wicked tantrums. Case in point. When my little Jilly Bean was 6 and her sister was still just a gleam in my eye, we planned a family getaway to the beach. I invited my cousin Ellie, visiting from out of state with her kids, her brother Ty, and my cousin Kevin, who had to work. On my way to Uncle Craig's house, where we had planned to meet up, I got a text from Kevin that I didn't read until I was pulling into the driveway. Kevin.
I'm sorry. I'm so fucking sorry. I don't know how she found out.
At that exact moment, Carol stepped out of the house in a robe and a big floppy sun hat.
There you are, dear. You can help me load my bag on the luggage rack,
she said, which is how I found out she was expected to come with us. Just like that. No invitation. No one even told her we were going. I coolly explained to her that there was only enough room in 2 cars for the people we had invited out, but logic bounces off her head like a bird flying into a window. She said, I could just drive and hold Jill on my lap. That's how they did it back in the day. I said that was unsafe. She said it was fine. I said it wasn't fine. She told me not to be difficult. Finally, I snapped and told her she wasn't invited, wasn't wanted, and could fuck off for all I cared. She made what is colloquially known as a cat butt face, but didn't throw the loud tantrum I'd been fearing. No. What she did was much worse. Taya and I decided to get some last minute sunblock and took Ellie's husband along to show him around. When we got back, I was pulled from the car and handcuffed on the hood while my terrified daughter watched. Carol told the cops I was a drug addict who had stolen her niece, that the other 2 men in the car were my accomplices. Well, that was sorted out. It took hours. Carol took Jill for a ride in her car and told her all about how she'd be living with Carol now, that her daddy was in jail and her mommy was going to leave because of that. Jill was crying to the point of hyperventilating when they pulled back into the driveway and met my wife, who Kevin had summoned knowing his mother's tendency for bullshit. I don't know what kept my wife from murdering Carol right then and there, but she grabbed Jill and went to work getting us free. When I got out, I just hugged the both of them, kissing them over and over and promising Jill she'd never have to live without Carol, ever. And Carol? Carol didn't see that she did anything wrong. I mean, you've seen how she reacts to things. She genuinely thought she deserved to go with us, and that making a false police report was a proportionate reaction. What can you even do with someone like that? Grandpa, still kicking at this time, apologized to me for Carol's behavior, but told me to forgive my aunt in the interest of family. But enough about that. You want to hear how we got rid of her, don't you? Well, you can tell from these stories and my use of present tense that Carol is still alive. We, as a family, hope so, at least. To start things off, Uncle Bob and Aunt Amy got married. It was a blast. Bob wore sunglasses, we did the hustle. The reception was shoes optional. Carol just sat seething through the whole thing because she couldn't successfully steal attention in such a big shindig. She tried her best, though. She wore a white dress to a wedding and had numerous fake fainting spells. Tragically, she had no date and no mugwump to feed. Well, the wedding could have gone on for days, but it wrapped up at 11. We were all staying at this B&B in town, and as such decided to carpool because there weren't enough designated drivers to go around. I plopped into the front seat. My wife piled into the back with my girls. We were merry with good food and drink, and Carol opened the driver's side door. Few things will sober your ass up faster than fear. Carol was a terrible driver, to the point where she had no longer had a license. Well, the drink slowed my response times, and I was unable to snatch the keys from the ignition before Carol shut the door and started the car.
Ugh, glad that's over.
Carol rolled her eyes and screeched into reverse. I winced as I heard the crunch of my taillight hitting someone's back bumper. My wife squeezed our girls in the back seat, all huddled together like frightened rabbits. The thing about being in a dysfunctional family is that it messes with your reactions. A normal person might respond to someone just getting into their car and driving off by saying, "Pull over, or I'll call the cops and tell them you're abducting us." We stayed quiet, hoping Carol would just take us to the B&B without too many incidents. I was in no state to drive anyway, and it was such a short way. How much damage could she do? God, the mental gymnastics I went through. Well, we missed the first turn off to the town. Katie piped up.
Auntie Carol, we were supposed to turn back there.
Hush, sweetie. Don't talk. It distracts the driver.
I let that one go. There was another turnoff coming up. She could make that one. All right, just up here. You see that sign? We turn here. You see that sign? You see that? She cruised right by it, squinting.
What sign?
I gave a growl of frustration. My wife's face was white in the rearview mirror. Carol, stop the car. I want to get out.
Nonsense, dear. We're in the middle of the country. No reason you should have to walk.
Carol drove on. The road was dark because there were no streetlights out here in the countryside. I thought of so many things. Engaging the e-brake, grabbing the wheel. But I wasn't alone in the car, and was afraid of what a panicked Carol could do to my family.
Oh, there it is!
There was a turnoff coming up, almost invisible from the amount of overgrown weeds. Carol put on her signal. Carol, this isn't the bed and breakfast.
Of course it is, dear.
Carol turned too fast, making my stomach lurch.
I was just here this afternoon.
You'd think a minute into our drive up the long, winding path would clue her into the fact that this was not the restored colonial building that sat on a busy street between an antique shop and a wine bar. But no. The driveway finally ended at a large white house that had bad news written all over it. The windows had sheets tacked over them on the outside. The yard was so overgrown, Katie could have walked into it and disappeared. There were men, silent, staring men in white clothes that walked up as the car rolled to a stop. You'd think that Carol, squinting over the dash, would finally realize that this was not our destination. Instead, she turned off the car, took the keys from the ignition, and opened the door.
Excuse me, which one of you is the valet?
A man stepped forward, hand out. Carol, god damn it, no! Before I could even get my seatbelt off, she handed the keys off to this gentleman in white. Someone opened my door. The men were at the front and back doors gesturing for us to come out. Katie was wide-eyed with fear. Jill looked like she'd bite the first hand that came near her. Well, I decided I wasn't getting my keys back, just sitting in the car and got out. The men were looking at Carol's white dress.
What a lovely thing,
one said. Carol, whose biggest weakness was vanity, blushed.
Aren't you nice, young man?
Carol? I tried to keep my voice steady. This isn't our hotel. I want the keys back, and then we can drive out of here and pretend we never saw any of you. No harm, no foul.
Oh, poo. You don't know how to be nice.
She turned to the men.
I'm so sorry for my nephew's manners. Do you have any coffee?
My girls pressed into my back. My wife had her arm tightly around me, ready to go down swinging. The man who took our keys tilted his head. Then he turned and started walking to the house. No! I pressed forward as much as I dared. She doesn't speak for my family. I do. Give me those goddamn car keys and let us go. The man didn't move. Carol smirked at me.
You see what being rude gets you? Lila raised you with no manners, no manners at all.
She tossed her head and walked after the man. So, picture this. It's dark, in the middle of fuck knows where. I've got no car keys and my family clinging to my back. We're surrounded by a bunch of creepy, no-expression dudes dressed entirely in white. What the hell do you do? Well, when you figure it out, go back in time and tell me. I was a complete blank. All we did was sit there and shiver until the men started moving. They bunched up behind us until I felt compelled to walk forward. One of them drew it besides Katie.
I'll take that,
he said, reaching for her hand. Katie screamed and flinched back. Jill bared her teeth and pulled Katie further into her. The man looked down at Jill's plum-colored dress.
That is not a pure color.
I let that go without comment. I was coiling up for a big strike, ready to cave someone's head in. The man looked up at me.
Is she not pure?
It took a minute for the phrase to trickle in. Is she... Are you asking if she's a virgin? Yes. We were being led out to the yard. There were large hedges, styled into weird abstract shapes. White sheets fluttered between them.
No.
Jill said.
I fucked tons of guys. And girls.
And the little one?
Rather than deck him for implying my youngest daughter was a slut, I shook my head. Katie trembled in her pretty pink dress.
And her?
My wife laughed out loud.
Take a guess for that one, Sherlock.
The men stopped. It was very unnerving. They were completely silent. The only sound in that yard was our frightened breath and the wind flapping through the sheets. Through the leaves of one hedge, I saw a branch so smooth and pale it looked like an arm.
Then the woman, Carol, she is the only one?
Sure, I snapped. The man who had been speaking nodded. We were grabbed from all directions all at once. The girl screamed.
Then you must come with us until we can persuade you to part with her.
Wait! I screamed. Wait, wait, wait. You can have her. The men paused. Katie was sobbing. Jill was twisting in their grip. So was my wife. I'll give you Carol, I said. And all it will cost you is my car keys. The men turned as one to the house, like they were listening. Finally, one of them said,
It is good.
As we were escorted out, I saw one of the hedges swaying in the breeze. At least I think there was a breeze. One of the men met us at the car, keys in his palm. I swiped them before they had a chance to change their mind. It's a funny thing, Terror. My family just shuffled into the car like we were leaving church. I think we were all kind of numb from shock as the car bounced down the long, winding road. It wasn't until we hit the road again that I woke up, stepping on the gas so that the tires screeched. I drove with one hand on the wheel, the other holding my wife's as we pulled into town. The girls looked shell-shocked. When we finally parked and got out, I gave each of them a nice, long hug. We couldn't sleep properly, so we piled onto the suite's bed, the girls sandwiched between us, and sat up talking. It's very telling that no one missed Carol until weeks after the wedding. Kevin called us up, said,
"Hey, it's Kevin. I got a notice from my mom's kennel service. Her Yorkie had only been paid through 2 weeks, and now they want more money."
Carol was first and foremost a dog lover, so this was actually out of character for her. No one at the wedding knew where Carol had gone. She wasn't actually on the designated driver's list. I guess getting into our car was just a whim. That, or Kevin's girlfriend had kicked her out for one too many passive-aggressive jabs, and no one had paid much attention to her after the reception. We had come in kind of late. Had we dropped her off? I maintained eye contact with my wife and spoke calmly and slowly. I had gotten us lost after recklessly deciding to drive tipsy. I hadn't seen Carol. None of us had. My wife gave me a small, approving nod. They never found Carol, but they never looked very hard for her either. The family healed over it, like a tree heals around a chopped-off branch. And Carol? Yeah. I hope she's still alive. I hope those spooky assholes never figured out that she wasn't pure. That she was just vain enough to deny it. I hope she lives a long, full life with both feet planted firmly in the ground.